Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to all of you online and those tuning in from all over the world. Shout out this morning to Rose in Camrose, 92 years old, I think, just a few days ago. And so your son asked me to shout out to you. And in Uganda, to the churches that are watching, God's blessings to you. For you, it's 7 o'clock at night. It's 7 o'clock at night in Uganda right now. Also to the churches in Hudson Bay and Mustadam, in Melfort, in Nipawin, blessings to all of you. I see some of you are tuning in. Blessings to all of you. To Warren in Florida, to Mrs. Aiken, as we remember and pray for your family in Calgary, I think that's all those who had asked me to consider them today. A lady and her husband, and I forget their names, Aiken is the last name that I remember because of Gary, but 90 or 92, her husband is the same. They're not very well people, and she went and was vaccinated and somehow got COVID, either from the vaccination or just after. They don't know which, but she is quite sick, and she is the primary caregiver for her husband, who is not well. And so we remember them in prayer today. When we pray for healing, let us remember them in particular as they struggle. And I think with that, we will begin our Good Friday worship service. This service we're using today is one I have used on a number of occasions. It is called the Seven Last Words of Christ. And we will begin with these words from Isaiah. If you would please turn to your bulletins. Folks at home, if you have your Bibles, please turn to Isaiah 53, 1 through 3. 53, 1 through 3. Isaiah 53. Evelyn, if you would lead the congregation's part.
Okay.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We gather here to worship God.
We gather to remember how Jesus suffered and died for us, and to thank God for his love and his mercy.
Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?
He grew up before God like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground.
He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering.
Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him out.
We will continue with our first hymn, How Great Thou Art. Somebody has swiped my hymnal. Do you have a celebration hymnal handy there?
No, I only have the one.
Please, no, that's not the right one. Somebody took my hymnal. Okay, probably me. Go ahead. How great thou art.
I see the stars, I hear the
Let us turn to our bulletins, to the prayer, the opening prayer. Let us pray.
Merciful God, as we remember how your Son Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross, how seven times he spake seven words of love, we ask you to bless our hearing.
Father, as we recall how all 3 hours his silence cried for mercy on the souls of all, we ask you to help us to understand the mystery of your love and make us into a people who are ever more worthy of it.
Amen. The first word is from Luke 23:33-34. When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed Jesus to the cross there, and the two criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing."
They do not know. They who killed Jesus. And who is they? It's so easy to name others, to blame others. The Romans, the crowd, Pilate, Herod, Caiaphas. They all played their part and conspired against Jesus, or simply followed orders to maintain the peace, to keep Jesus' kingdom from infringing on theirs. And yet, where are we when Jesus' kingdom infringes on ours, on our peace, and on our order, on our prosperity, and on our security? Where are we when the victims of our peace cry for justice? When those disenfranchised by our order call for compassion? When the hungry and the lonely beg us to share our prosperity, our security, our power? Where are we when Christ is crucified among us? Surely he should have raged at the sinners who nailed him to the tree. Surely he should have raged at us for the evil we constantly do. The evil we do both knowing and unknowing. Yet compassion is there in the first words that he utters. He intercedes for us before the Father. Compassion that called him into being in his very mother's womb. Compassion that compelled him to the cross. Compassion that brings incredible, unbelievable grace. Compassion that echoes through the centuries to all who participate in the killing of Christ. Compassion that cries out from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
The second word is found in Luke 23, verses 39 to 43. One of the criminals hanging there threw insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. The other one, however, rebuked him, saying, Don't you fear God? Here we are under the same sentence. Ours, however, is only right, for we are getting what we deserve for what we did. But he has done no wrong. And he said to Jesus, Remember me, Jesus, when you come as king. And Jesus said to him, I tell you this, today you will be with me in paradise.
How much are we like the thief, full of anger because we're not rescued from our sin? We're full of hate because we suffer because of the sins of others. How much do we want God to just snap his fingers and make right what we have made wrong, what we have allowed others to make wrong? How easy it is to cry, save us, and to rail against God when there is no magic cure, no miraculous recovery, no legions of angels to take away the pain and bring wholeness. How easy it is to scorn the Messiah and to mock the goodness of the world and condemn the light of the world because we're unwilling to face what it is that we've done. And yet there's goodness. There is a cure for sin and death. A cure that doesn't promise magical solutions, but promises that the pain of sin is not the end. And that's when all this is over. When the suffering is finished. That the final word is not torture and defeat, but life. Life springing out of the ashes, like transformed, life transformed and life fulfilled in paradise. To the compassionate thief, to the one who could still recognize the good in the world, to the one who tried to comfort and protect that good, to the one who sought good, Jesus gave that man comfort. Today you will be with me in paradise. Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
We'll sing our next hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
On which the Prince of Glory died.
Third word, John 19, 25 to 27. Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother, his mother's sister, Mary of the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there. So he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time, the disciple took her to live in his home.
Who can grasp the grief of Mary watching her son suffer? The film that we're showing this afternoon, The Passion of the Christ, one of the scenes is Mary coming into the courtyard of Pilate and witnessing her son being beaten. I can't even imagine watching someone strike my son, what that would do to me. And they didn't just strike Jesus, they tore him apart. Blood covering the ground. And in the film, they show when Jesus leaves, Mary takes off a covering and she sops up the blood of her son. What gift can a man give his mother? What can he offer when he is gone? How can he help her, hold her, comfort her? Honor her. Woman, here is your son. Here is one I love, to love you and for you to love. One who knows me, one who is my brother and who can speak of me, one who can hold you and comfort you and honor you, one who shares your grief. Here is your mother. Here is one I love for you to love and to love you. The one who taught me, the one who fed me, the one who wiped away my tears, who hugged me, the one who grieves with me. Woman, behold your children. Children, behold your mothers. Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
This next hymn, I'm sure most of you know off by heart, Amazing Grace. What number is it?
343.
Amazing.
The fourth word, found in Mark 15, 33 to 34. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
Of all the agony of that torturous day, the lacerations of the scourging, the chafing of the thorns around his head, the convulsions of his tormented, dehydrated body as it hung in the heat all the day, nothing reaches the depth of the anguished cry of desolation. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus, who found his purpose and strength in the presence of God, who was sustained by the immediacy of his relationship with God, and who endured all by the tangible power of God, all was at work within him. All was a center of vitality and peace. Suddenly found himself totally alone on the cross. Jesus, who was in every way God, found himself utterly, absolutely, disparagingly cut off from all that gives life and breath, cut off from all that gives purpose and hope, from the source of his being, cut off even from himself, plumbing the depths of the human condition to walk in the place of the utter absence of God, in the place of sinners, in the place of those who reject God. God abhors sin. He cannot tolerate it. He cannot be in the presence of it.
He simply will not be. And when Jesus ascended the cross and bore all the sins of all of us for all time, the darkness and the depth of sin that he bore was of such significance that his Father had to turn from him and look away, because God could not look upon him draped in our sin. My God, why have you turned away from me? Why have you forsaken me? In these words is the central mystery of the crucifixion that we just can't understand. That there is no despair so deep, no disgust so deep by God looking upon the unending amount of sin that Jesus bore, or placed so far removed from joy and light and love from the very heart of God, that God has not been before us, and where God cannot meet us and bring us home. That's the place of Christ. Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
I have often used the example, and you've heard it many times already here in Sundry by me. But if we were to take two of the most beautiful white sheets and put them up on the wall, and on one of those sheets make a small black dot in the corner, and on the other take a bucket of black paint and throw it up onto the wall, the question would be, which of those sheets is no longer perfect? And the answer is, of course, is both of them. Which of those two sheets are unacceptable to God? And the answer is both of them. Because it matters not whether you sin a little or you sin a great deal. God abhors sin, and there is only one way to get rid of that sin, and that's to have it washed clean by the blood of Christ. And so from that cross, his blood ran down the cross and collected on the ground. And that blood washed away our sin. This next song is called, Are You Washed in the Blood? I've lost a little yellow strip. What page is it? 330. Are you washed in the blood?
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood?
In the blood,
in the soul.
The fifth word is found in John 19, verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, "To fill the scripture, I thirst."
There's a kind of timelessness about hanging on a cross, I'd imagine. It's not quite death, but you most certainly know that you are nearing death. You also know that there is no way out. Over in an instant, in one glorious moment of martyrdom, like being torn apart by lions, a cross is as much an instrument of torture as it is a gallows from which to hang. And as the day wears on, seconds stretch into minutes that stretch into hours until there's a point when time can no longer be measured. Just imagine for a few moments a nail has been driven through your feet. You can't move your feet because they're nailed to a piece of wood. And every time you try to put your weight on your feet, that nail tears through your muscle and your sinew. And the pain must be unbelievable. And so you probably move from putting the weight on your wrists that are also nailed to wood, like you're nothing. So between hanging from your wrists and taking the weight off your feet, and then putting the weight onto your feet and taking the pain from your wrists, you go back and forth, and every time you breathe, you have to push up. Your body starts to weaken, and its ever more insistent demands for that substance which is so vital to love, to life, so foundational to all living things, so basic to existence as we know it, water. You're so thirsty. Water to moisten a parched mouth, to free a swollen tongue, to open a rasping throat that cannot gasp enough air. Water that keeps hope alive, to keep life alive just a few minutes longer. Water to a crucified man is life. Oh God, Thou art my God, I seek Thee. My soul thirsts for Thee, my flesh faints for Thee, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Who can tell if these words from Psalm 63 went through Jesus' mind? But a thirst for water is a thirst for life, and a thirst for life is a thirst for God, who promises streams in the desert and mighty rivers in the dry land and living water to wash away every tear. Here at the end of it all, those promises seem far away, seem distant, and yet Jesus, forsaken by God, still clings to the memory and the hope for life. I thirst. Lord Jesus, You gave Your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
The sixth word is found in John 19, verses 29 to 30. A bowl was there full of cheap wine mixed with vinegar, so a sponge was soaked in it, put on a stalk of hyssop, and lifted up to his lips. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished."
The Roman soldiers had a drink that they would use when they had to sit for long periods beside a cross, when they were guarding something. And it was a very sour mixture of cheap wine and vinegar, and for some reason they liked it. It was a foul, foul tasting mess, but it was close. And so when Jesus cried out, "I thirst," someone took pity upon him and they grabbed something like a sponge, a cloth, and they soaked it in this stuff to put something to his lips. What a sigh of relief, what a cry of deliverance that finally, after seemingly endless pain and gasping torment, it is over at last. And the suffering is ended. The ordeal is finished. And nothing remains but the blessed peace of the absence of all sensation. When all there is pain, its ceasing is the greatest blessing of all, even when its ceasing comes only with death. But Jesus' cry is more than just welcoming the ending of pain. It is more than joy at the deliverance that death brings him. He doesn't merely say, "It is over." He says, "It is complete, fulfilled, achieved, accomplished." Jesus' cry is not a cry of defeat and despair as one finally loses a battle, but it's a cry of success and triumph, even at that moment of death. The race has been won, that he had endured to the end, that the strife is over, the battle is won. And Jesus' cry is a cry of relief, to be sure, but it's also a cry of victory. The work I came to do, that I was born to do, is over. It's complete. There is nothing more to add. It is finished. Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
There is a song I sing on Good Friday. I've been doing it now for a long time, 20, more, almost 30 years. And it's called "Watch the Lamb." And I'd like to sing that for you today. I have to make all this equipment work.
Walking on the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. "Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand." So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. There will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. And I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, crucify him! We tried to leave the city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and I said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second man was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross and falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Till a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, carry his cross. At first, I tried to resist him, but his hand reached for his sword. So I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I laid it on my shoulders and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And on the cross, I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands, I commit my spirit. Prayed and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time. Then I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. and I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us the lamb ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms. We turned and faced the cross. And I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
Absolutely beautiful.
Thank you.
The seventh word is found in Luke 23, verses 46. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last.
It's the end, the very end. This horrible ordeal, the end of the suffering, and Jesus alone on the cross, tortured, exhausted, abandoned by his friends, forsaken by his father. He gasps for a last breath and gathers the strength for one final cry. Why would he choose to speak so close to the end? Why would he muster the last energy he had to cry out with a loud voice? Couldn't God have heard his thoughts? Unless God wasn't the only one intended to hear. Unless his voice was pitched loud so that we too might hear his final dedication of his soul, a dedication made despite the pain, despite the mocking, despite the agony, despite the sense of horrible aloneness that he felt. A dedication made to God before the resurrection, before the victory of the kingdom, before any assurance other than that which faith could bring. He entrusts his spirit and his life, all that has given it meaning, to God in faith. Even at the point of his own abandonment, when the good seems so far away, he proclaims his faith in God, and the darkness cannot overcome it. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Lord Jesus, you gave your life for us.
You suffered and died that we might be made whole.
Let's just take a few moments. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted.
But he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole.
All we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all.
He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and the rich in his death, although he had done
no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. We will sing the first two verses of Were You There?
in a bulletin.
We'll sing all the ones in the bulletin.
Well, so then the girls have to get the bulletin.
Here, I've got one here. Yeah. Lord God, you have given us everything.
You have not held anything back.
Help us in like manner to give of ourselves.
Sanctify us in Christ's name. Bless us in all that we think, feel, say, and do, that we, like Jesus, may be a blessing to others.
We ask this and all things that we ask of you through him saying the prayer that he taught us. Our Father.
Who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We will sing the last 4 verses.
Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Oh, sometimes it calls. Were you there when
Receive the benediction. Depart now in peace, and may the Spirit of Christ go with you. May his faith and trust abide within you, and may the knowledge of his love support you both now and forevermore. Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord. The ushers will direct you out. Please leave quietly. And thank you so much for watching today, and may the Lord bless and keep you. We will be live again at 7 a.m. Sunday morning for the Easter sunrise service, and then again at 10:30 a.m. for the regular Easter service. If you're watching from here in Sundry and you're going to be attending the service, please call the church and register for Sunday so we know exactly how many people we have to deal with. If you are able to come at 7, please do that so that we can balance the two services. So God bless and keep you. Love you all very much. Bye-bye.